So hello everyone, and welcome to our lecture series, International Studies Institute. Peace from Conflict to Reconciliation is the theme of the whole second half of the semester, twice a week schedule that we have. My name is Eleni Vaste, and I'm the director of the International Studies Institute. The associate director, Kristen Tower, is sitting there, and we're both very excited to see colleagues from within UNM, within the United States and abroad, joining us for this series. Today's presentation by Vangelis Calotychos is funded in part by a grant from the Modern Greek Studies Association and also from the European Union delegation. And I'd like to thank the Colorado European Union Center of Excellence and Felicia Martinez for making these events happen. Vangelis Calotychos was born in London of Greek Cypriot parents and was educated at the University of Birmingham, then at Harvard University. He has held a full-time faculty appointments in comparative literature and Hellenic studies at Harvard and New York University and Columbia University. And currently he is visiting associate professor of comparative literature at Brown. During the spring of 2015, he was also the Alexander Onassis Foundation senior scholar there. Now his principal research has focused on Greek literature and culture in an interdisciplinary and comparative context. His first monograph, right here, Modern Greece, a Cultural Poetics, came out in 2004, and it discusses the nature of modernity in Greece from just before the founding of the nation state in the 1830s to the present. And he's a prolific author and one of those scholars who always thinks outside the box. His most recent book, The Balkan Prospect, here, Identity, Culture and Politics in Greece after 1989, came out in 2013. It is a literary, filmic, geographic, and cross-cultural analysis of Greece's position within and without the Balkan and Europe after the Cold War. It received the Edmund Kelly Book Prize from the Modern Greek Studies Association. In the 1990s, he also studied Greek and Turkish cultural relations and promoted interdisciplinary work on Cyprus, most notably in the edited volumes Cyprus and Its People, Nation, Identity, and Experience in an Unimaginable Community, 1955 to 1997. That book came out in 1998. And he also was in charge of a special issue of the Journal of Mediterranean Studies that came out in 1999, entitled Divisive Cities, Divided Cities, Nicosia. In 2012, he also edited a set of essays commemorating the work and life of a major Greek poet and major figure in Greek culture, Manolis Anagnostakis, Poetry and Politics, Silence and Agency in the Greek Post-War, and that came out in 2012. And before we move on with the lecture, I also want to introduce Mark Childs, my colleague from the architecture program and associate dean of research in the School of Architecture and Planning, who will be the commentator for Vangelis's lecture. Mark held a Fulbright position in Cyprus. And also I want to recognize Justine Andrews, who is here from the Art and Art History Department. She's an art historian who focuses on the Middle Ages with original work on Cyprus and in Cyprus, and she also held a Fulbright scholar's position there. So with all of that, it's really an honor, and I know it's going to be a pleasure to listen to my guest's talk. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Eleni for her gracious invitation out here to New Mexico, and to Mark Charles for his invitation to a Tex-Mex restaurant yesterday at lunch. I'm only sorry that I'm unable to stay longer to make my way into the countryside and to the mountains, but I'll have to leave that for some other time. The Cyprus problem is one of the best known intractable examples of ethnic conflict and a lack of resolution in the world today. It has some dubious distinctions, one of them being that it has kept the United Nations peacekeeping force on Cyprus for longer than any other country has managed to keep such a force. A dubious distinction that now runs for more than 50 years. What I plan to do today is to present to you a little bit of the background to the Cyprus problem, or Cyprus issue as it's often referred to, and then in the later part of the talk, touch on some of the things that perhaps interest you most, which are initiatives around peace and reconciliation on Cyprus, and hopefully some of the context that I'll provide earlier you'll be able to follow, and you'll also find the ways in which that context has impinged on the workings of such initiatives over time. In the last couple of years, there's been a game changer, or a possible game changer, as Joe Biden referred to it, and that is the very likely discovery of perhaps large, perhaps not so large deposits of natural gas and perhaps oil around the island of Cyprus, towards the south and east for the most part, towards Israel and towards Egypt. And this has raised hopes that perhaps this will be an incentive to the major players, states, great powers, multinationals, to exercise benevolent force, hard to believe, on Cyprus and facilitate a solution. And every time I use solution, I guess we should put it in quotation marks. So I'm not going to speculate on the nature of those reserves, the quantity of those reserves, and how things will map out, but I'll take from it the issue that we're looking into the ground for an answer to our issues, or an answer to the solution. Interesting, because the notion of looking to the ground and relating oneself to the earth and the ground is, of course, very often a nationalist gesture. That is, to feel oneself a right to the very ground from which one springs up and rightly lives in a particular piece of real estate, as it were. But at the same time, I thought I might be able to structure some of the examples in the later part of the lecture around peace and reconciliation, around the issue of the ground. So, a little scurrilously, I offered this short cartoon, short, I guess, perhaps, because they're crouched down, to Eleni for the flyer for this lecture. And here we have a Turkish Cypriot leader, Mustafa Akinci, remember that name, on the left, and Lelos Dimitriadis on the right, who was a longtime mayor of the capital of Nicosia, sitting together on two toilets around the late 70s. This event, inauspicious as it may seem, does in fact hold a key to some of the efforts at peace and reconciliation, both after the war of 1974 and, in fact, as we'll see at the end, events today. So what is this place we are referring to? We're referring to an island, Cyprus, which in the last 20 or 30 years has been represented somewhat like this, an island which is scarred by a line of division across it. This is the so-called buffer zone between two parties, mostly the Turkish Cypriot community of Cyprus on the north of the line, the Greek Cypriot community on the south of the line. The buffer is manned by the United Nations peacekeeping force. And for those of you who viewed the documentary that I sent on to Eleni in preparation for this class, there is also the one village of Pila, which is curiously situated in the buffer zone and within a British base on the island. And that's why it happens to be the village which still retains a mixed population at this time. It's a very funny documentary. If you have a chance to see it, you'll see a very ironic and I think very insightful view of the efforts at coexistence on the island. You'll notice also in the northern part that the entity of the north is described as the Turkish Republic of Northern Cyprus in quotation marks. This is because that name was declared by the leadership of the Turkish Cypriot side in 1983, but it was recognized and has been recognized only by Turkey. The internationally recognized state or entity on the southern part is the Republic of Cyprus, which in theory covers the whole of the island, and it's a member of the European Union. However, the administration of the Greek Cypriots in the south has no jurisdiction, no practical jurisdiction over affairs in the north, and we'll be looking into the history of that history selectively as we move forward. So this was actually the situation when the two gentlemen were sitting on the toilets here, because the capital city, Nicosia, had also been cut in half, had been divided, sliced in the middle, and that caused a number of issues which needed to be confronted, and the issue at hand in this example was shit, basically. How to deal with sewage, which is, of course, under the ground until it comes and rises over the ground. Cyprus is in the eastern Mediterranean, of great strategic importance, perhaps in the past more than today, always on the border between the West and the East, Christian empires, the Caliphate, very close to the Middle East and the Suez Canal, therefore of great interest to the British, the maritime power in the region, always. As you can see, it's also of great interest to the two major constituencies, communities on the island, the Greek and Turkish communities, more about that later, who once were, of course, Muslim and Orthodox communities. And as you'll see from the location, Cyprus is very close to the Turkish coast, which gives Turkey a great military advantage over Greece in some of the conflicts that have taken place over time. Here's the island again. Now, if you stereotypically asked a Greek Cypriot why this island is his or hers, Greek Cypriot will probably say that, yes, Cyprus has always been at a strategic crossroads. It's been overrun and invaded and occupied and conquered and exploited by many different powers. But for 2,000 years, there's always been fundamentally a Hellenic or Greek presence on the island, right? That would be a Greek position, and that there is a continuity in that tale. And in fact, it might be dressed in a kind of folkloric manner to say that the people, the regular people on the island, right, were for centuries identifying themselves as Greek. The Turkish Cypriots, on the other hand, would say that, in fact, it was a much more complicated story, and that these mixings that had taken place before did not allow for a separate entity or an easily available Hellenic or Greek identity. And they would stress the perhaps more diverse composition of the population until, funnily enough, 1570, when the Ottoman Turks conquer the island and it becomes part of the Ottoman Empire. There's, of course, a surge of Ottoman Turkish settlers. There's the conversion of some Orthodox members of the populace to the Muslim faith. And the island is then from 1570 until 1878, ostensibly a bit of a backwater in the Ottoman Empire, but nonetheless part of that empire. In 1878, the British are more or less invited to the island by the Turks in exchange for some kind of security and support against Turkey's problems with the Russians. However, 30 years later, in 1914, the Turks side with the Axis powers during the First World War, and this leads to the British to take Cyprus away from the Ottoman Turks, momentarily offer it to the Greeks, who for complicated reasons don't accept it, right? And eventually in 1923, as part of the Treaty of Lausanne, Cyprus is relinquished by the Turks, and in 1925 it becomes a crown colony. So my father at that time becomes a British subject, and by his good graces, I also received a British passport sometime later. As you can see, the population of Cyprus, as we work through some of those dates, shows that the relative composition has stayed very similar even down to our days. 73% Orthodox Greeks, 24% Muslim Turks in 1878. In 1891, it's thought that there were 346 mixed villages on the island. In 1932, and this is after an uprising by the Greek Cypriots in 1931, this goes down to 252 mixed villages, but obviously people like living in larger numbers and feel vulnerable when they're in small villages, so there is some kind of consolidation. And then after the troubles, or some of the troubles that I'll be relating as we move forward, it's down to 48 mixed villages, and now, for all intents and purposes, the one village featured in the documentary I sent on to you, the village of Pila, is the mixed village emblem that has remained. I always stop myself short a little bit in talking about Orthodox Greeks, Muslim Turks, right? Identities, I think, are much more fluid than that. But from the period of nationalism onwards, these populations had to ascribe an identity to themselves in nationalist terms. And there was a feeling that among the majority Greeks in the 20th century, the island deserved to unify with mainland Greece and become part of mainland Greece, which itself was expanding in geographical expanse throughout the 19th century into the 20th century. However, there were still moments when not only were Greeks and Turks living in a kind of interdependence in villages, in relative harmony, but moments also when, as in 1948, Greek and Turkish workers came together in a strike over conditions in the mining industry, supported in part by a very strong, and it's always been very strong, communist party in Cyprus. Wasn't a good time to have your interests promoted by communists at the time. Remember, we're talking the late 40s. There's a Cold War going on. There's a civil war going on in Greece, where the Americans and the British earlier were putting down that communist insurgency as they saw it. So it was no surprise that the issue of the future of Cyprus would be taken up not by the left, generally speaking, but by the right. In 1949-1950, the Church of Cyprus, which had always had a very principal role to play in the affairs of the Greek Cypriot community from Ottoman times, since they were the representative of the Greek Cypriot or the Orthodox community to the Ottoman port, demanded from the British that Cyprus be ceded, unified to Greece, something that the Greek Cypriots refer to as enosis, union. Right? This was found a very charismatic proponent in the Archbishop in 1950, Archbishop Makarios III of Cyprus, who was the leader of the Greek Cypriot community. The British did not heed these requests, and what began as a referendum that took place in the churches of the island, where people signed, 95% of the Greek Cypriot population signed their wish to unify with motherland Greece, what began in that form 4 or 5 years later began took the turn to an armed struggle, which was led by an organization known as EOKA, the National Organization of Cypriot Fighters, who began an anti-colonial struggle against the British and were supported by many parts of the, well, the largest, a very large percentage of the Greek Cypriot population. Here you see that population, younger members, students marching in support of EOKA with Greek flags in the background. Of course, this preoccupied the Turkish Cypriots, who are a minority, who wondered whether this would turn from an anti-colonial struggle into something else, and what would their position be in a unified Greece, where they would be an even smaller minority in a larger entity. The British were aware of this, and in a characteristic example of divide and rule, they began to use the Turkish Cypriots against the Greek Cypriots. This was easy in some aspects. For instance, many Turkish Cypriots were members of the police force on the island, and as a result, they were often put in the rather sticky situation of having to control Greek Cypriot members or sympathizers of EOKA. This photograph is a very interesting photograph from 1956. It shows an assassination from the time, and I just wanted to dwell on it a little bit. It's actually the assassination by EOKA of two British spies working on the Lithras Road, which is the main pedestrian road that cuts through Nicosia, which at the time was known as Murder Mile. Right? What's interesting about this is that this photograph is available also in a Turkish Cypriot museum nowadays, where for a long time it was presented as being the death of two Turkish Cypriots on the Lithras Mile. This is not to say that there weren't killings of Turkish Cypriots, as we'll see, right? But it's a sign of the tension and also the anxiety around this, and in a kind of curious way, the effects, really, of British-Turkish-Cypriot relations at that time. In other words, by promoting Turkish-Cypriot positions to a certain degree, the British thought that this might help them in confronting the issue of union with Greece and stymieing those efforts. Remember, it's 1956, 1957. The British are losing Suez, they're losing Egypt, right? They're losing their stake as a colonial power around the world. They don't want the same to occur in Cyprus. It wasn't long before the Turkish Cypriots themselves organized their own paramilitary groups. TMT is the Turkish paramilitary group of the time, and there were open hostilities between Greek Cypriots and Turkish Cypriots. One of the individuals here, one of the leaders of the EOKA movement, is Nikos Samson, and we'll come back to him. He is also alleged to be the assassin in the picture that we saw earlier. More of him later. By the end of the 1950s, it's unclear how the struggle will develop, and the spiritual leader Makarios, in conversation here with the military leader of EOKA, are clearly discussing the way forward. Eventually, that way forward was a compromise in the form of the agreement by Turkish Cypriots, Greek Cypriots, and the British to declaring the independence of Cyprus. That is, not the union with Greece, and not what the Turkish Cypriots had in the meantime demanded, which was partition of part of the island and its unification with Turkey. This is something that nobody wanted, apart from the British perhaps, and maybe not even they. What came out of it was a constitution that would chart the way forward for this new independent small island republic in the eastern Mediterranean, with the guarantee of the British, the Turks, and the Greeks. We'll come back to that in time. In fact, they even sat down, and in fact, the person who devised this was a Turkish Cypriot, a new flag, which is the flag of Cyprus, which shows the island from a distance, right? Rather strange color for an island, certainly not the red of Turkey or the blue of Greece. Olive branches for peace underneath. This was a flag that much later a Greek Cypriot leader referred to as the greatest flag in the world because no one would ever die for it. It wasn't long before that republic and its constitution ran into problems. It was clear that both sides were preparing for conflict in the interim. It was also clear that the constitution was unmanageable, that as hard as Makarios, in fact, tried to work to a certain degree with the Turkish Cypriots, because he had understood that it was unlikely that any other solution was on the table, extremists from his side were moving in the other direction. The Turkish Cypriots as well had themselves been making preparations and were wary of any kind of change to the constitution, which eventually came in 1963 with amendments to an impractical and unworkable constitution that led to further skirmishes in the capital, Nicosia, and on Cyprus, that led to many deaths, including massacres in villages. And over the course of the 1960s and following on from these events, brought Greece and Turkey close to war. This is something that the Americans and others certainly didn't want in the middle of the Cold War, because after all, these were NATO allies, which came very close to coming to war over Cyprus. And this was actually averted only at the last minute. As a result of this fighting, the minority Turkish Cypriots found themselves retreating into enclaves on the island. Right? Here's a picture of a TMT woman fighter leading members of her community, children, into the enclaves which were protected by the TMT. Reputedly at that time in 64-65, 1.6% of the island were such enclaves, and maybe 40% of the Turkish Cypriot population was residing in those enclaves. It's a very important point, because for the Greek Cypriots, the Republic of Cyprus, the independent Republic of Cyprus in 1960, survived, continued. For the Turkish Cypriots, looking back, they considered that the Greek Cypriots had annulled that constitution, that they had violated it, and therefore there was no independent republic to talk about. The machinations between the two sides continued into the 1970s, and I'm simplifying things, but from a Greek Cypriot perspective, the events led to a rift between the more extremist line and the more compromising side that sought ways of including the Turkish Cypriots and re-continuing relationships on the island. However, in Greece, from the period of 1967 to 74, the country was ruled by a military junta, which by 73, 74 was on its last legs, and like many military juntas, think of Argentina and the Falklands Island, needed some kind of grand spectacle, some kind of grand victory to survive in power. This they attempted to effect with a coup attempt in Cyprus to kill Makarios at the presidential palace. They failed, right? And take over the country and immediately declare the union of Cyprus with Greece, right? Makarios escaped, only come back and fight another day, but in the days following, the declaration was made as fighting occurred between rightist and leftist Greek Cypriots in Nicosia and elsewhere. And the leader of the Republic was this man who we saw earlier, Nikos Samson. Nikos Samson, who was the assassin in the slide from 1956, had been considered by the Turkish Cypriots as a perpetrator of massacres in villages in the mid-1960s. So obviously, if you're a Turkish Cypriot in 1974 and you're seeing this, you're considering that this is not a very hopeful sign by any means. Not only this, but since the Republic was guaranteed by Greece, Turkey, and Britain, even though this action was perpetrated by a junta and one that in the meantime had fallen in Greece because of these actions, the Turks argued that as a guarantor of the island's independence, they could intervene since one of the other parties, Greece, had violated the independence of the island. The British weren't doing anything. The Turks intervened. And in the summer of 1974, they landed on Cyprus. They bombed from the air. And at the end of the fighting, the Turkish army occupied 37% of the land in the north of the island. 200,000 Greek Cypriot refugees fled to the south of the Green Line. 40 to 50,000 Turkish Cypriots later were obliged to settle to the north of the Green Line. So, in effect, the island had been cleansed. 1,619 Greek Cypriots were reported missing, and 600 to 9,900 Turkish Cypriots were also reported so missing, some of them not from the events of 1974, but earlier from the events of the 1960s. All right. Of course, in terms of the legality of the Turkish action, the guarantee status of Turkey allowed for it to return matters to the status quo ante, that is to the status quo before the violation, which is something that didn't happen. So many would say that there is no legal claim to the right to intervention, but for the Turkish Cypriots and for many Turks, this was a peacekeeping operation and is referred to as an intervention and not an invasion, which it is characterized as by the Greeks. So we have refugees, we have refugee camps, we have a line of division across the capital, Nicosia. Here you see me many, many years ago on a very, very hot day, standing before, on the Greek side, standing before the sentry post, between it and the Turkish sentry post on the other side, you have just these dilapidated buildings shot with holes, which have remained empty ever since 1974. Another checkpoint on the Greek side. Again, the view from the Greek side, looking out over the so-called Green Line, the Green Line that divides the island, which was actually a name that was given for it after the fighting in Nicosia in 1963. So there are problems here. In 1974, we don't have freedom of movement. We don't have freedom of settlement. That is, no one is allowed to pass across the line in either direction. And people have lost their homes. There's a problem of property ownership on both sides of the line. There's also an issue of identity that comes up at this time, which is particularly interesting. Now, you would think that it would only be a question of vilifying the other side, so that the Greeks became more Greek and the Turks became more Turkish. But there were many people who, on the Greek side, for instance, were dismayed by the actions of the Greek junta and the fact that the mother country had intervened and unsuccessfully attempted to unify with Greece. This meant that there was some consideration of the way forward and how that might be affected by reaching out to the other side, right? Still vilifying the Turkish mainland and the Turkish state, right? But at the same time, reaching out to the fellow Cypriots, Turkish Cypriots. And there was some consideration in the time in a movement, a small movement called the New Cyprus Association, to consider the definition of Cypriot identity, and to put that forward as a kind of wedge in between these ever more aggressive and emphasized Greek and Turkish identities. Now, from the Turkish side, you'd think that it was all hunky-dory. Certainly, they had gained a measure of security that they hadn't had for the 15 years before that. However, soon, the regime on the Turkish Cypriot side brought in many settlers from mainland Turkey to populate the island, and also demographically lead to a kind of shift in the proportions between the two sides. This caused tensions between Turkish Cypriots and mainland Turks living on the island, and a kind of reconsideration again of Cypriot identity as a result, right? As marking the difference between these inhabitants, clearly ethnic Turk, and their Turkish mainland brothers who and sisters who were on the island. Also, the regime was, in the 1970s into the 80s, very nationalistic. It managed to purge the island by one way or another of many of the leftists in the island who found themselves setting up shop in London, right? Moving to the old home of the British colony. In the political realm, there's Makarios again, once again the leader of the Greek Cypriots. This is with Kurt Waldheim, the leader of the UN, and Ralph Denktash, who is and was for a long time the leader of the Turkish Cypriots, right? Meeting in Geneva and elsewhere to flesh out a solution. And in the first few years after 1974, there was some progress. In that it was generally understood by that time, 77, which was the year that Makarios died, that some kind of solution could be found in a bizonal form of federation. The problem was, and has been always, what do we mean by federation? What is the relationship of the two constituent parts? The Turkish Cypriots, on the one hand, generally held the view that federation was, for all effects, a confederation, that there were two legal entities with minimal ties, right, running their own affairs separately. The Greek Cypriots, on the other hand, thought of a federation that had a clear international face, right? A Republic of Cyprus that had proportional representation in on the island and could legislate all matters in a typical unicameral or bicameral representational democracy. The hopes of a solution, I think, from that point on, not only with Makarios's death, but with the rule of Ralph Denktash, were pretty much stymied. Denktash was very clear in his beliefs that he had to stick it out. That is, that he would push back any attempts on the part of the international community, which officially only recognized the southern part, the Greeks part, as the Republic of Cyprus. He would hold back all these until realities on the ground, literally, would have the international community acknowledge the existence and the viability of a separate state in the north. In fact, famously, and of course he was also behind the policy of bringing in settlers from mainland Turkey, with the thinking that there's no difference, we're all Turks, right? So we can all live on the island. His position was, in terms of the label Cypriot, that there is no such thing as a Cypriot. The only Cypriot are the donkeys. The donkeys in Cyprus are known as a particularly superior breed, right? Mules and donkeys in Cyprus. And he said that the only Cypriot that existed on Cyprus was the donkey. So on the next day, and this was actually quite late in his life, some activists on the Turkish Cypriot side led a donkey to the border checkpoint that had then been set up, demanding that the donkey be allowed to venture to the other side, precisely because it had the rights of the only one who had the rights of a Cypriot citizen. This little image here is actually from Palestine, and it's Banksy. Similar idea. This is a soldier who's at a checkpoint checking a donkey, although I don't know if the donkeys have the similar significance in the Middle East as they do in Cyprus. So we're left in this situation, which produces a very heavily politicized discourse. And in fact, apart from having a father who was Greek Cypriot, my other sort of interest in involving myself to a certain degree in affairs in Cyprus in the late 80s and early 90s was a kind of academic sensitivity and feeling of unfulfillment around the heavy political toll that had been taken just by language, by the fact that everyone would talk about the Cyprus problem, and the problem would be delivered to you in these very tried and tested formulas, which constricted any kind of freedom of thought about the issue. And I lived this in London, in fact, and so I felt that there was a need for other kinds of initiatives other than the formal initiatives that had been taking place at a political level. So I was very much in favor of conflict resolution workshops at the time, invitations to more anthropologists to involve themselves in how the ethnographies of the island played themselves out in daily experience. And what we find is that alongside the formal political process in Cyprus, we also have informal attempts, or less than formal attempts, to find a way forward in the Cyprus issue. This brings me back to the first slide, and I wanted to say a little bit more about the initiative that took place between two leaders of the community in the capital Nicosia around that green line in 1977, 78, 79. These were actually what we would call the mayors of the two parts, although of course neither side recognized the other, right? and therefore had to come up with names to allow the process to go forward. So they were referred to as the representative of the Greek Cypriot community and the representative of the Turkish Cypriot community. The problem at hand was that there was no central sewage system at work in the city. It was supposed to have started operating sometime in the mid-70s, but the actual treatment plant, which was located in the north, had, of course, been cut off from the workings of the rest of the system in the south. So some secretive bilateral meetings took place, and they were the only meetings that took place, aside from the ones that had taken place between the leaders of the two entities. So they also took place beyond the official umbrella of the UN organizations, and instead found a more fruitful context in the United Nations Development Program, which was concerned with down-to-earth things like funding and technical issues, rather than with explicitly political issues, although, of course, they're very hard to separate. The two parties didn't keep any meetings after realizing, after the first two or three meetings, that otherwise it would be a simple waste of time. And eventually the UNDP, through the World Bank, provided finance and technical advice. The two parties set up strange procedures because they couldn't receive a loan from the World Bank, for example, and the money couldn't be given to the Turkish Cypriots, who couldn't sign contracts because they weren't recognized. So at some point, the two sides agreed, again rather informally, to allow for the giving of a grant to one side and the other through the World Bank. With the assistance of the UN at the Lidra Palace, which is a hotel which is caught in the middle of the buffer zone, a meeting place was set up. By 1980, the sewage system was ready to operate, and before any publicity was given, the mayor on the Greek side is quoted as saying, "We connected certain units on purpose, thinking that those who might disagree would then be rather reluctant once it became evident to act against it. For example, we connected the sewage system for places like the Russian embassy, the American one, the hospital on our side, the main hotel on the other side, and so in effect, if anyone objected, they could not easily just go and cut these connections. This way it worked. I think that those days were just before the elections for Mr. Akinci, and I feel that this helped him rather than harmed him because he was subsequently elected. One should also bear in mind then that there were people objecting to any kind of talk or contact between the two sides, and not only on the Greek side." All right. So this was really a breakthrough, and Akinci, again, I tell you, remember that name, Akinci, an architect himself, was especially sensitive of other urban planning issues, and therefore promoted with his counterpart a larger plan, which was known as the Nicosia Master Plan. Not a very good slide, sorry about that. They had, in the meantime, studied the issue of division in Berlin, and in the case of Berlin, they understood that if the city was ever to be reunited, there would be all kinds of problems integrating the two sides. That is, roads that wouldn't meet each other, right? That would miss each other. There were traffic issues. All these had to be considered. And for a period of about 15 years, from 1980 to about 1995, the group that worked with the master plan worked on both sides with a projection of the plan of Nicosia that might come into effect were the division to end. Also, the other interesting thing about the city at this time and the effect of division is that from being the very heart of the republic, the heart of the state, because this was the line of division, the buffer zone, not only the buffer zone, but the area around it was undesirable. Nobody wanted to live next to a borderline of sorts that could any day, due to another conflict, be shifted one way or another. So incentives had to be given to bring in young people into this area and to revivify the urban network of the city. And this, in fact, they did. So there was also a pedestrianization scheme that ran through the buffer zone, but of course nobody could actually pass through it. This led to a number of, I think this led or was symptomatic of a spirit of such exchanges that took place. And as the 80s wore on, there were many bicommunal initiatives for bringing members, ordinary people from the two communities together, very often at that hotel, at the Lidra Hotel, to meet and talk again and find a language that was different than the language of division that had been cultivated and to a certain degree impressed on everyone through the TV and through the political parties and everybody else. These were always complicated situations because, after all, they were often funded by external bodies, by the United Nations, by the Fulbright Commission, by the United States in other ways. So there was some suspicion of the aims of such initiatives. And people, well-meaning people in many instances who took part in them, very often were scorned by people from their own communities, right, as being naive, etc. So they had to weigh up, on the one hand, the image of themselves as perhaps traitors to some kind of other evil intentions from the outside, and their own wish to find some kind of common ground with Turkish Cypriots, with whom, of course, as the years wore on, from the 70s into the 80s into the 90s, there had been no contact, right? These initiatives, I think, were necessary for the eventual attempts at the beginning of the 2000s in 2004 to put a referendum on the table, a plan to reunite the two sides. However, this plan was voted down by the Greek Cypriots and voted for by the Turkish Cypriots. It's rather complicated. It's a rather complicated situation, but I mention it now, and I can talk about it later, but I mention it now just to say that it was a plan that was formulated, I think, with a great deal of intervention by the United Nations and foreign parties, which led many people to believe that this was part of a larger process in which constitution-making, which we've seen in Afghanistan and Iraq and elsewhere, is sometimes engineered from beyond the shores and then cultivated in some of the thought processes and in the workings of the people on the ground to be able to receive and accept the terms of those plans, right? I don't mean to present the workings of such initiatives as black and white. I'm precisely saying that the people who involve themselves and try to unstick the process of coexistence and rapprochement very often find themselves before very serious personal ethical dilemmas, and the answers are certainly not clear. In many ways, the overriding political atmosphere on the island has always influenced the initiatives for peace and reconciliation, and I'll end by just mentioning two briefly. The first is the issue of the dead, the people who've been killed on both sides, and finding out what happened to many of the dead. There was a lot of abduction and hostage taking in the 60s. There were a lot of soldiers, of course, who were killed in the war of 1974. There were irregulars on both sides who committed atrocities against villagers and people were never seen again. There's also the issue of Greek Cypriots, rightists and leftists fighting each other in 1974, before the Turkish invasion, which is a rather embarrassing episode for the Greek Cypriot side. So after the war of 1974, there were attempts to put into place programs that would consider the fate of those who died. By 1977, the UN had a committee on missing persons, as it was referred to. But Turkey didn't recognize it, believing that it was going to be one-sided and would be focusing primarily on the victims of the Turkish invasion of 1974. Work in that committee actually drags its heels. It begins in 1981 or is established. It work doesn't really begin till 1984, and we can't really say that there are any definitive results until 1997 or 1998, and the first identification that takes place is in fact of a US citizen, due in part to American pressure on the issue. An anthropologist, Paul Sankasia, has also made an interesting distinction about the way the Greek Cypriots and the Turkish Cypriots confront the issue of their dead. The Turkish Cypriots refer to them as kayipler, that is, those who are disappeared, as dead or lost. There is a finality about the way they consider that. The Greek Cypriots use the word agnomini, those of unknown fate. We don't know what happened to them, right? Perhaps they are living persons, and there's been a lot of speculation about individuals, and this was cultivated a great deal in the 70s and 80s, of people who had gone missing and reputedly were in prisons in mainland Turkey, never to be heard from again. In that conception of the dead, there seems to be no finality. And Sankasia's case, and it's very interesting, is of course that this is reflective of a larger position. The Turkish Cypriots, for them, the issue, the Cyprus issue, for many of them, is a finished matter, right? It ended in 1974, right? A state was, secure borders were set down, and that these people died for a cause. And memorializing them is really giving the blood to the existence of the new entity, the new state. For the Greek Cypriots are always considering that this is not the end, that we need to restitute, to bring the political situation back to what it was before. And the version that is often projected is one of relatively harmonious coexistence in the past. And that's what we should be aiming for. And in that story, the condemnation on the Greek Cypriot side is towards the mainland Turks and not to the Turkish Cypriots, focusing on the fact that in their minds, those who died during this period and are missing were victims of the mainland Turks and not the Turkish Cypriots, with whom, right, they believe they can create again and extend the borders that have de facto been put in place of the Republic of Cyprus to include all citizens of the Republic. So when one looks at images of Greek Cypriots, portraying their lost and missing, the idea is that they're not memorializing them as dead, but very, very much offering their pictures so people can recognize them and give them information. Right? There are memorials in Cyprus. There's a museum, actually, to the missing, and you can see some of the figures here of the brothers and fathers who are missing, the pictures, but them also included in the photographs, kind of these kind of whorish figures in the background. The Turkish Cypriot side tends to go for more cenotaphic representations, right? That is, empty memorials which you can, as Anderson tells us, stand in front of and project your own loss onto that emptiness, right? And that becomes something that every Turkish Cypriot shares and understands is the basis of the sacrifice which underpins the Turkish Cypriot state, the so-called Turkish Republic of Northern Cyprus, which, as you can see, has a kind of inverse colored Turkish flag, right? And lastly, one more picture from a cemetery on the northern side. You can read here, armed Greek Cypriots and Greek thugs tried to eliminate everything Turkish to achieve Venice. It's very pragmatic, matter-of-fact language, very different from the language of loss and nostalgia on the Greek side, and perhaps we could actually culturally extend that even beyond the crisis as a kind of predilection, a cultural predilection of both sides. In 2004, as I say, the Greek Cypriots rejected a plan to basically implement what had been on the table since 1977, which was some kind of compromise. The Turkish Cypriots would give a little bit of land, 8%, 10%. The Greek Cypriots would give recognition of some sort. The federation would be fudged, right? It was my recollection at the time that I spoke to a lot of people after the referendum on the Greek side, actually, more than on the Turkish side, on the Greek side, and realized that for the first time, because of the referendum, people in families discussed the issue in pragmatic terms. For decades, they had discussed it in terms of loss, in terms of mourning, in terms of atrocity, in terms of barbarism, but they actually confronted the issue as an issue of pragmatic resolution. And clearly, the Greek Cypriots weren't ready for that step, although I would argue that there were also aspects to the deal that were not to be accepted at the time. About a week later, after the referendum, the Greek Cypriot side, the recognized Republic of Cyprus, entered the European Union. So what you have now is a state within the European Union that it remains divided, right? Albeit with some passage through checkpoints since 2003, right? However, you still don't have freedom of movement, since you go over a checkpoint and have to return soon thereafter. You can't settle, that is, you can't buy property. So a Greek Cypriot, for instance, is in the position of being able to travel anywhere in the European Union, but not to the other side, to the part of the island where perhaps his home village is, and settle in the house that perhaps he owns. The same goes, of course, for the Turkish Cypriots, except that because the southern Greek Cypriot side presents itself as the state of all Cypriots, it's more open to accepting claims from the Turkish Cypriots for their properties in the south. Similarly, the Turkish Cypriots have instituted a tribunal or committee which is, in theory, open to giving compensation to Greek Cypriots for their properties in the north. However, there's pressure put on citizens of both sides to not go that route, because it would be recognizing the other side. All right. And lastly, here we see the gentleman from the first slide, Mustafa Akinci, the one-time Turkish leader of the northern part of Nicosia, the municipality, who is now the president of the Turkish Republic of Northern Cyprus, meeting with his Greek counterpart over the last year and bringing to the table certainly a much more open sentiment and a will towards solving the Cyprus issue. So it remains to be seen if we have yet one more failure, or whether this time As the clock is ticking, since this can't last for too much longer, a decision is finally taken and some kind of resolution to the quandary takes place. Thank you.
So, thank you for taking a cut through a very difficult, very complex history. And if there's anything I learned in my time in Cyprus, is that you can tell this story a number of different ways. In fact, you cannot even name a town with, in a sense, taking a stance. If I call it Nicosia, that's really the English name, as opposed to Lefkosa or Lefkosia, or Libra. We go back to ancient names, and people actually use those names as a way of a shorthand of taking a position. It's a very complex and beyond me, really, situation. And I think it's almost a sport at some level. I really appreciated the set of photographs that you've assembled of situations and times that I spent a fair amount of my time trying to find a lot of these photographs of different instances, and it's astounding in and of itself. But I also think that that's part of the story of Cyprus now, is how photographs are used to represent the past and other groups. I noticed that while I was there, I made a very systematic view of what images of the city of Nicosia were represented, where posters were, where images of the history of the city. And it was astounding that about 70% of the images I found in the north part of the city were of the south. And a little lower percentage in the southern part were of the north. So they were actually, they were trying to make whole in some way through the photographic image and posting that in a public space. I have a whole set of questions that I can leave, but I'd rather not if there are questions from you all. Anybody? I'll start. Go ahead.
I was just wondering if, I'm just curious. Somebody, remote interest, but with a number of conflicts that are going on in the world, being Irish, Northern, Southern Ireland, what have you, the issue in Israel, Palestine, Afghanistan, there seems to be, again, you know, I know I stand to be corrected, but is there any encouragement by the United Nations, shall we say, since they have been there maintaining something of a stalemate, the encouragement to the leaders of both sides to employ, as an incentive, you might say, to adopt this peacekeeping effort and this effort to unify as a model for other people who suffer, shall, you know, experience similar situations, say the Northern Irish, so, you know, the Republic of Ireland and things such as that.
I didn't quite understand I didn't quite understand.
Well, it seems to be that, I mean, there's been a lack of armed conflict.
Absolutely.
You know, whereas in other areas of the world,
absolutely,
there isn't. And I'm wondering if there is some effort to encourage these people that what they're doing and what they hope to accomplish could be employed as a model to other people who have similar issues.
All I'd say is, and I know this is not what you're saying, but there's an argument from the
Turkish Cypriot side, that, and it was one that Denktaş used, who was the hardline leader from 1974 through to 2007, 2008, when he passed away, I don't remember quite, that in fact this was a successful paradigm in that the numbers of people killed had been managed from that time, and the situation was much more stable than it had been in the past. I suspect that Kissinger also, in the 60s and in the early 70s, had projected, and the Americans had projected, a solution of this sort to the instability that had existed in the 1960s and the threat of the two sides coming close to war. Clearly, from a Greek Cypriot perspective, one couldn't accept that kind of logic and would have to make the ethical argument that people are kept from their homes, from their livelihoods, from their freedoms, while at the same time the situation remains as an unstable one in that it hasn't been addressed to everyone's satisfaction. There have been moments in the last 20 years where there have been incidents on the island that have raised tensions, and including tensions as a knock-on effect between Greece and Turkey. So while I accept your point, I just wanted to present it. The other thing is I'd present it in the terms of the sides on the island. And lastly, to say that the United Nations is certainly unhappy about the kind of money that it has lavished on the peacekeeping operation. And there was discussion, I remember, 10 or 15 years ago, especially when the Greek Cypriot side was doing extremely well economically. People were talking about the Cypriot miracle, how Cypriots who had become refugees in their own land in the 1970s had managed to work up an economy that was striding into the European Union, right? This was in the 1990s and the early 2000s, that they should bear some of the cost for the peacekeeping efforts. That was difficult to figure out because the Turkish Cypriots were not in an economic situation to do it. So the Greek Cypriots would, of course, say, well, you know, why would we be paying for them? Which is a position that they take also on a number of proposed peace settlements, because the Greek Cypriots very often bring up the issue of the investment that they would have to make up for the inequities on both sides, as well as paying for what they find obscene, generally speaking, the leadership, at least the Greek Cypriots, which is paying for the settlers, some of whom now have been there for 30 or 40 years, from mainland Turkey, who are citizens of the Turkish Republic of Northern Cyprus. And so there is some discussion as to whether they should be included in the settlement, or, it sounds like Donald Trump, be sent back or deported, right? I mean, there are realities on the ground which make this difference. So the economic side of the issue as well is something that one would have to bear into consideration. Mark.
Two things. The Nicosia Master Plan has, in fact, and I've had multiple conversations with different groups, been used as a model of civil society building. And in fact, the term really got some more weight behind it because of that. Let's just, we'll deal with the infrastructure, we'll get people to meet each other. When I was there, one of the student Fulbrights, she arranged for a quartet of people from both sides to perform on both sides. So that kind of civil society building model has, in fact, people at the Nicosia Master Plan office when I was there were really hesitant to talk to people because they had been sort of overstudied. Academics and diplomats from all over the world had been talking to them. It's like, how did you do this? And they felt exploited about that. I absolutely agree with this point that, however, in some ways it may have allowed this 50-year rift to continue. that's hard to know. You know, alternate histories are very difficult to really know, but I understand the argument there too.
May I just also say that it was the hardliners on the Turkish Cypriot side, Denktash, who agreed to open the line in 2003 and allow the flow of individuals, including tourists, for periods of time, at that time one day. It also allowed Turkish Cypriot workers to come to the south for work, right? That is, it's an admission before the referendum in 2004 and before the Greek Cypriot side entered as the Republic of Cyprus into the European Union, that to a certain extent it was untenable to stay the way it was. So there's an answer there to that issue. However, the issue of the security of Turkish Cypriots is something that weighs on Turkish Cypriot minds, but everyone seems to think that some of those fears have been allayed in the last 15 years by the prospect of the European Union, right? And of course, any solution would introduce the northern part of the island automatically into the European Union, and you would have Muslims in Europe, right? You'd also have at least this was discussed at the time. It was discussed also 10 years ago that, in a kind of cynical way, that allowing a smaller number of Muslims into the European Union might ward off discussions that were taking place 10 years ago about Turkey's accession to the European Union and the fears that many Central Europeans had about admitting 70 million, 80 million Turks into the... So there was that side of things as well.
Would you say that Britain is the origin of this situation? And the second question is linked to it. What is the position and role of Britain currently on this conflict?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not one to so easily throw it in the lap of in the lap of outsiders. I mean, the British clearly disengaged from Cyprus unwillingly and leaving behind the seeds of ethnic dispute among the populations that
they always do,
they oversaw. However, there were other actors involved, clearly the two home mainlands as well, that manipulated events on the ground in Cyprus as well. The British are, I think, dogged in their wish to retain their bases on the island, which are very important listening posts for the Middle East and Russia, I understand. But in some of the draft agreements that have been set out over the years, they were even willing to give up part of their land around those listening posts, but not the listening posts themselves. So the British still have a vested interest, but I don't think they still have the same geostrategic interest that they had in Cyprus throughout the 20th century. I think those coordinates have significantly diminished, I think.
In some ways, I think that you say anything, it's wrong, right, at some level, but that maybe some of the continuation of the situation is to the benefit of a number of different parties. It's kind of a open, wild situation in some ways. You have Saudi, just as a very small kind of example, you have Saudi princes driving their cars in the northern part of the state at, you know, clocked at 150 miles an hour. You have the Turkish army being able to do certain kinds of exercises that they couldn't do in Turkey. You know,
same for the British.
Same for the British.
The British can do things in Cyprus they cannot do in England. What kind of exercises did they
have? Military training.
Right.
Opportunities.
Sorry, I'm a Cypriot. I just want to know if I'm the only Cypriot in the room. May I ask?
Mm-hmm. And I'm a professor here at UNM, and I taught. I wanted to keep my mouth shut because I love this presentation, but at the same time, I just wanted to let everybody know, if I'm the only Cypriot.
No, please.
I used to be the area chief of computer engineering. You capture it so well, and you balance it so nicely. I think there is hope. I've lived here, and when I went back, I don't know if I may share my experiences.
Yeah.
I have never seen more hope than I see today. And
what are you talking about, though? Going back
for a resolution.
Going back when, though? The last couple of years?
I came to the United States in 1987. And I crossed the border, okay? I don't know if anybody has ever felt what I'm about to describe. Imagine yourself, you look at the Sandia Mountains every day, and you are not allowed to go, okay? That's how I grew up. And if you try to go within a line, you get shot, get killed, okay? And there were many people that were killed, and that was the turnaround point that brought in. There were, at one point, a bunch of Greeks decided, we're gonna cross, we don't care what, in the United States, I mean, I'm sorry, this is my vision. And I'm not a politician, I'm not a professional. I think the United States is the reason that there has not been a conflict. Definitely the 1974 ceasefire with the U.S., mostly Kissinger got involved. The Greek lobby brought him down with the Israeli lobby afterwards for what happened, what he did there. He's not a very well-liked figure in Cyprus. Mm. But since then, the U.S. has intervened and really helped, I think, brought a lot of stability. And the reason is because Greece and Turkey are in name, I mean, roughly. And I'm just going to share one more thing about conflict there, because I was in there, a soldier, when you said conflict. There was only one time where there was a possibility of real conflict, armed conflict, that I remember, okay? There were two, actually. One is India that happened in Greece, but that was controlled by President Clinton, and that was diffused. But the real one happened when they declared independence in 1984. And at that point, there was a lot of talk about attacking from the Greek Cypriot side, the Republic, the Turkish. And that was serious, because somebody came up with the idea, and I don't know how true it is, that if you want a state to be declared illegal, you have to attack within 8 days, and therefore, whatever. I don't know. It was just the same. And my feedback is, growing up in the island, what you learn is that, as a Greek Cypriot, even though I had Turkish Cypriot friends, look, the only question is how many of us are going to die when Turkey invades and takes the whole island, if we end up in a war, and if the price of our death is high enough so they won't do it. So obviously, the Greek Cypriots weren't going to attack because we just felt like the inferior power. So if the superior power has all the, is happy with the situation, and the people who feel like they were wrong don't have the ability to do it, then you're going to get peace. Now, you might argue that's the same thing going on in Palestine and in the West Bank, but I don't think so, because there, the Arab states really felt at one point that they could take on Israel. So I think that's the difference. That's my own. Sorry.
You want to talk about the hope?
The hope, oh my God. Look, do you want me to share?
I like it.
Sorry, I don't want to steal. It was such wonderful. Okay. So I crossed. Remember, this is the border. You look at the Sandia Mountains, you can't cross, right? So I love it. So I went with a car with another Greek. We all studied abroad. By the way, Fulbright committed scholarship because of this problem. That's why I got a scholarship to come to the US to get more understanding. Mm-hmm. But I betrayed the scholarship by staying in the came back and stayed in the US. But I did go back. Okay, never mind. So everybody's happy with me. I didn't bring any loans. Okay, so.
So 2003, when you had the opportunity, they opened the line.
Yeah, I can talk to you about the resolution because I lived there and it was amazing. I mean, the experiences, I've never seen anything like that. The resolution. So I cross it and then I go over and you know, we got stopped by a military, I don't know, 30, 30, I won't go into that. You did a great job. By the military, and you know, I was in the army. They stopped us. They realized, because remember, the carrier driving has the license plate that identifies you as a Greek Cypriot. And they just delayed us, and nothing more happened. We crossed, and we went to Kandara, I think one of the... Within 5 minutes, they realized who we were, and the Turkish Cypriots who were in charge called us. They said, oh, you know, you came to visit us. He wanted to tell us stories. He bought us coffee. We sat down. We had a wonderful time. It was incredible, okay? It was incredible. People crossed. This is another one that I don't know if you can document it, but the story is a bunch of people crossed. Remember when the border came down, it was brought down, and people were crossing to go see their houses. Mm. What do you think happened? They went and they knocked on the door of their house. In 30 years later, well, all the stories, and my brother, one of my brothers was the first ones to cross. He was in the BBC, he was interviewed. They were welcomed inside. They were brought in. My brother still, we still went out with the people that occupy his house. There is hope. It's amazing. It's like the border wasn't there. The people love to talk to each other, okay? Probably the turning point happened in Greece earlier on, when there was the earthquake. I don't know if you remember the earthquake.
Late 90s. Yeah, yes. There were two earthquakes. There was one in Greece and one in Turkey, and each side came to the support.
I think that came before the Cyprus. Anyway, yeah. At one point, I was in a conference and in Cyprus, in the south. And then somebody shows up and says, look, we have a presenter from Turkey. And the room went applauding. Amazing. They had never seen, you know, the people were so hungry to meet each other. I mean, it's like it breaks down everything you hear, you believe, you know. The people are there, not by nature. There is whole respect for human life. And, you know, when I was growing up during the invasion, during the war, there was so much talk about, you know, killing and all that, and no respect. And what you see today is completely opposite. And I don't want to monopolize, I'm so sorry. Because they were so beautiful.
Go ahead, you.
Okay. Actually, I kind of wanted to jump off of what you said about that a little bit and ask you, I wanted to see what your thoughts are on the idea of like cultural memory being passed down between generations. Because like right now, I actually go back and forth to Cyprus a lot. And a lot of my friends there were born after the events of 1974 and after all of that. But still, there's this discussion amongst a lot of them about the influence of their parents and their grandparents from their experiences of those times. And I was kind of curious what your thoughts would be on having those sorts of memories passed down and what sort of impact that would have on younger generations building better relations between the two communities and working on a piece
of agreement. Yeah, I mean, two things. And one, I think Eleni will appreciate, because Eleni's done a lot of work on a much earlier trauma of Greek relations with Turkey, which was in 1922, which was a defeat and a war in Turkey that led to the expulsion of a very large community of 1 million Orthodox Greeks to the Greek mainland. And subsequently a transfer of 400,000 Muslim Turks to Turkey from the Balkans as a result of this. The language of loss, the language that deals with trauma, has certain clearly defined cultural characteristics. And I would go so far as to say that some of the same kind of narrative elements that people use in order to talk about their loss reproduces itself culturally in Cyprus 50, 60 years later. I was telling Mark yesterday that this experience in 2003 of somebody crossing over the line and being able for a day to go to the ancestral home, to their own house in the village,
was for many people a difficult experience, because for 30 or 40 years, especially the elderly ones, had lived with this language of, when will I ever be able to go back to my home, right? To be able to sit in my garden, to feel in all kinds of spiritual and existential senses at home. And they did, and of course, you know, Turkish Cypriots opened the border, they went, they actually lived this experience, they went to the house, people came out from their homes, gave them photographs that they found in the world, personal trinkets, they had coffee together, and then at the end of the day, they packed up and went home. And suddenly they had to deal with the issue is, you know, how do I relate to this narrative that I have used for all these years to deal with my own personal pain, right? I need to revise the narrative. For many, it was very difficult, and many of them decided not to go back again to that house. Or some continued to go back, developed relations, but also talked to you about how they're unable to go beyond a certain point, you know, and they're left, you know, with a more complicated experience which doesn't have a narrative to describe it yet. So they feel homeless in another sense. I said to Mark, although it's actually based on a few real observations, I had a number of friends, Greek Cypriots, who went to the north and had given it a lot of thought. And there are, of course, I don't know, it's probably half or 40% of Greek Cypriots who haven't agreed to cross, who are unwilling to cross for all kinds of reasons. People have gone since, but I'm still not sure what the figures are. But there are still some who doggedly, for ideological reasons, will not go under these terms. And they think it's a trap, and it's, you know, agreeing, it's recognizing again the other side's gesture and statehood, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, there was a big issue, because if you remember, when you had to cross over, you had to show your passport, but of course, it wouldn't be allowed to stamp the passport, because that would be recognition. So they used to put a piece of paper in that they would stamp, and then when you came back, you gave the piece of paper back. So there was no evidence on the passport that you had recognized the other entity. But anyway, some of these people who went begrudgingly, let's say, went back to their home village, said, oh, it was okay. They said to me, but you know what? In the main square of the village, the fountain, they said, the fountain with the water where we used to go, where my grandmother used to go and wash the clothes, right? It had all grasses. They hadn't looked after it. The water wasn't working. You know? And I had a number of instances where people referred to the fountain, and I'm like, you know, does every village have a fountain? Can it be? I mean, you know, and I kept thinking that this is sometimes, you know, when you're dealing with these situations, you present them in a way that digs deep into a kind of resource that's been passed on from generation to generation. I don't know how exaggerated I am in that, but I was faced with those descriptions, and I don't know if it's a cumulative effect of people's narratives, and someone hears the other person describing it this way and says, oh, that rings a bell. And then says, oh, yeah, by the way, within the village, yes, it was like that. The main square was. It's a little more complicated about the young, actually, and how the young feel about this, because, you would think that they would be more open to getting together with their cohorts on the other side of a similar age, and that they would be more open to putting aside the difficulties of the past that their parents experienced. But it's not clear, because when the referendum took place, I think there was a very high percentage of the young, very high percentage, who were against the solution. Of course, there were many reasons why people voted no. There were many reasons, but it's not automatic by any means. And it's, if you saw the documentary that I sent in as well, you'll see that there are various initiatives to bring the older generations together, because they have something to talk about as well, right? They have some memories of the past. And however difficult those first meetings, and that's shown very, very clearly in the documentary, however difficult, they do have something to resurrect.
I want to add one thing. one of her summary statements coming back was, you know, there's something really great about how Americans forget history. there's a way that you can continue to perpetuate things, the sins of your fathers and your great-grandfathers and your great-great-grandfathers. That is an interesting question. How much is that bringing forth the memory of old atrocities? In what ways is that useful to us? In what ways is it not useful to us? I'm not actually advocating forgetting in that sense, but maybe thinking about it as how close is it to your heart, and how examined is it? How do you really think about these things that, you know? I mean, actually, even looking at my own personal past, I know that some of my grandparents actually did really bad things to others of my great-grandparents. And, you know, so if I was too invested in that, what am I supposed to do, right? It's just an interesting question.
I know there's a gentleman there once asked, but I just to say that also there's a practical side to all this as well, which intervenes very often, and that is the people on the Turkish Cypriot side, the people on the Greek Cypriot sides, they have jobs, they have government jobs, they have posts in services, and they work for the water service and the electricity service and stuff like that, and they have power. In their own way, they have power, and they don't know what the next day will bring. They don't know. Change is something that can make people uncertain. Similarly, I mean, I always think, I mean, just to give you kind of experience on this, a very close friend who's very progressive, so but in general is a soft-spoken man in general, has always been clearly for, you know, reconciliation, and doesn't harbor any, you know, ethnic hatred, etc. But he's apprehensive about the prospects for peace, the insecurity that would come with a solution that might still offer an opportunity to extremists on both sides is something that actually makes him very defensive and conservative in his decisions about voting for such things. So, you know, there's a pragmatics on the ground as well. Of course, there are other pragmatics, which is, do you want in on the European Union and all the benefits that would come with? I mean, there are all kinds of pragmatics, right? There are all kinds of equations.
It's the stamp that they put on this paper. And then when I was there this summer, they stopped doing stamps and passports.
That's right.
And even like for me, after having been used to that and going to the checkpoint one day and saying, oh, yeah, no, we just need your passport, you're free to go. I was like, what? Oh, wow.
No, there are people crossing for work now, routinely. There are people crossing for work, and it's a much more fluid process. What it means, we'll have to see. Sir?
There are major political upheavals in Turkey these days. Is it still the case that political issues in Turkey could fundamentally change the course of what's going on the island now?
You know, it's funny, but my amateurish kind of view of events in Turkey, you would be surprised perhaps that Greeks, I think perhaps Greek Cypriots as well, viewed Erdogan, the early Erdogan, the first 10 years, as one of the more progressive leaders on such issues. Of course, things have spun out a little bit out of control, as far as I can tell, in the last 2-3 years, and I'm not quite sure where that might lead. But I think Turkey has more than enough regional issues of much greater importance than Cyprus at the moment. There are initiatives that are taking place and that continue to take place. And I don't know the degree to which Turkish accession to the EU is an issue anymore in the way it was in 2000, for instance. But they're involving themselves in the Cyprus issue. For instance, they have recently completed a project of providing water for the north of the island, which of course is looked at suspiciously from the south, even though the Turkish Cypriots and the Turks are presenting it as a solution to the water problem. From the south, the Greek Cypriots see that this is meddling in affairs, trying to stack the deck again, and having too much influence. At the same time as the Turkish Cypriots might say, but you guys, you Greek Cypriots, you always complain that if there's a solution, you guys will have to pay for all our insufficiencies, economic and otherwise. Here's a solution to the problem, and you're not willing to accept and get on board and cooperate on this issue. I don't know if Greek-Turkish tensions are really at the forefront at the moment. I don't think they are. I think they're much.
I want to ask a little bit to that from the way I saw it as a secret. So it's not a professional, and I know professional means because I just saw it today. Erdogan and the Cyprus has been the military success story for Turkey. And Erdogan basically declared war on the Turkish military and suppressed them.
Uh-huh.
And this is, therefore, by being more peaceful oriented towards Cyprus and Greece, he has managed to weaken, this is our work on the street can weaken the military. So, to the extent that all these conflicts lead to a rise in military power in Turkey, then yes, Cyprus will be affected because nothing is clear more in Greece or Cyprus than to have the military displace Erdogan or whoever. So that's my view.
Do you know, because I was told multiple times that a good number of the settlers from Turkey are actually Kurdish. The Turkish government was moving Kurds from Turkey to Cyprus, which is a, you know, another kind of dimension of this, but I don't know if that's true. I was told that multiple times. It could get, I mean, there are layers and layers and layers.
I'd like to thank
you. Thank you.